There were an error here, eh? The kinetic... No, the error is here. The action in dynamics is not defined really in this way, but in this way. Eh? Here you have an integral between two instant of times in dt. And this instant of time can be generally is they represent the initial time and the final time. So this is the equation in dynamics. However, I think that I will not have the time to introduce the dynamics today. So probably it is better to continue this lecture in statics. So you can see the difference. In statics, the displacement do not depend upon time. The rotation do not depend upon time. The action is not defined by the, I mean, the kinetic energy, if u do not depend upon time, kinetic energy is zero, because u dot is zero. Yeah? So kinetic energy is zero, and then you can remove also this integration upon time. When we will deal with dynamics, we will introduce again this integration. We will see how to deal with inertia. And from an historical point of view, the action was k minus u, but and in statics generally one do not say minus u plus ux, but the opposite. Eh? So in the books you will see this. Why? Because, I mean, but at the end the equation are the same, because you need to say that the variation of the action is zero for any admissible kinematics.
Excuse me?
Please?
But if you multiply action by minus one,
this equation are the same. Yeah. In fact, because from an historical point of view, one say kinetic energy minus u. In fact, if you want to say that this is a minimum, you should say the opposite, u minus k. But then, if you read the books, you see kinetic energy minus u. Maybe also maybe you have shown me the non-conservative force, the Lagrangian. In Lagrangian formulation, one say always kinetic energy minus internal energy. Even though in that case you find a maximum, not with this equation. In Lagrangian mechanics that you study at the university, standard course, you use this formulation for discrete system. So when the number of the degrees of freedom is finite, 2, 3, 4, 1. Here is infinite because u is a field. So you have infinite degrees of freedom, you have a field. But the equations will be the same, we will see easily. So also from you can introduce a Lagrangian and formally the equations are exactly the same for infinite degrees of freedom problem, for field problems. But anyway, we do not deal with dynamics, so it's not proper to talk about this now. Maybe in another lecture for dynamics. For statics, we should say what is u. Okay, u is very important because tells you how your system accumulates strain energy. First of all, in this formulation, there is no waste of energy. I have heard also some question on this type. Here, the behavior is elastic. That means everything is reversible. I have this pen, I make some deformation on this pen, I see the deformation. Then I remove the reason for this deformation, I remove the reason of this deformation, and then the pen come back to as the first one, as the first case. So everything is reversible, because there is no waste of energy. No waste of energy. If there is waste of energy, the variation of the action is not zero. For example, if I deform this pen, and this pen will be fractured. Someone want to do, who among you, yeah, you, if you have this fracture, of course there is no reversibility, because you cannot do. So here, if you want to deal with fracture mechanics, the deformation is irreversible. So this framework must be generalized. So it is important to understand what are the way in which you can accumulate this strain energy. I will introduce the strain energy for standard Euler beam. In another lecture, maybe we will see a general form for the strain energy and see what are the restrictions from general principle on the strain energy, also for nonlinear case and also for nonlinear case. But for linear case, U is equal to the integral from 0 to L of 1/2, and then you have, for example, kn w prime square, where the displacement u is equal to e1 w plus u e2. So if this is the beam, this is the unit vector e1, this is the unit vector e2. W is the axial displacement, and u is the transverse displacement. So if you as this, so that means that, but maybe we should say this, so that now we can say that u without the arrow is the scalar value that represents the displacement transverse to the beam. W is a scalar value, the displacement in the axial direction, and this u with the arrow is the vector displacement. The internal energy is one part of the internal energy has this form, where kn is the axial rigidity. You will see once you will do some Venam problem, maybe you have seen that this kn is equal to the Young modulus multiplication of the area of the cross section. But in a monodimensional theory, you don't have the area of the cross section. You have only kn. Then, if you are very smart and you do the San Veron problem, you can identify this kn with this. But this is only true once you have material that is homogeneous, isotropic, like this pen. No, this is not homogeneous, not isotropic, because there is an hole. So it's not true that you have to, you can deal with the Young modulus of the plastic. The area, so take care on this identification. This identification is true only for linear, homogeneous, isotropic, elastic, linear material. For generally, this Kn is different, can be maybe identified from experimentally. Then you have 1/2 Km theta prime square, where prime is the derivative with respect to x, and then 1/2 kt u prime minus theta to the power 2. This is u. So what does it, and then what is uxt? Uxt is the potential of the external force. So, I mean, on your body you can act from the external world in a different way. One way, for example, is to act on your body with volume external force, for example, the weight force. So for the weight force, what does it mean? It means that you have the gravity acceleration. So it is the potential of the weight force is mgh. No? So you have gravity acceleration rho dx. Now let us. It is better to write in this way. General weight force is BnW plus VtU plus mu theta in the x. And these are the action that occurs in a distributed way. Bn is the distributed action in the axial direction, because W is the displacement in the axial direction. You know that the work is force displacement. That means if this W is the displacement, means that Bn dx is the force in this direction, is interpreted a posteriori as the force in this direction. We can say, can be interpreted a posteriori as the force in this direction, as well as BT can be interpreted as the force in this direction, and mu, so the force is, the work is force displacement, but also moment rotation. Rotation is theta, so mu dx can be a moment. So mu is the distributed moment. Please?
Bn the force density or the
force? The external force density in the axial direction, external force density in the transverse direction, and mu external moment density, or external couple, distributed external couple. And however, from this point of view, from the point of view of the variational derivation, force, the word force and moment are cannot be can be even not mentioned. It is simply a function here, a number here. as well, it can be a constitutive number of your problem. It is a constitutive assumption on the action of the external world on your body. But at the end, in this approach, the only the fundamental things is the kinematics, because kinematics you can see the kinematics. The kinematics can be measured. You can measure a displacement. No, you cannot measure a force. A force, to measure a force, you should measure a displacement, and then interpret this displacement a posteriori as a force. So this is more intuitive from this point of view. A force is not intuitive.
A lot of these terms are actually density of force of moment.
You can interpret this BN as external force in the axial direction.
But they are actual density.
Yes, density.
But if we have
concentrated force, very good question, you should add something else, different from this. For example, you can have a force, for example, if you have something that you call force here, no? In this axial direction, F01, for example, then you have F01 multiplication of W in zero. I mean, you should add only the work of your external force, of your external action. Here you have distributed action, okay, can be interpreted in this way. You have concentrated action, so it is not an integral. Then a posteriori you see, but this may be in my course, someone has called this force. Someone has called this couple. And then you can interpret, if you want, then you can interpret as force, couple, and so on. But in principle, you have your pen, then you have some concentrated action because your finger is concentrated action. I do this way, so I do some action concentrated here, in L, for example, and then you add the force of my finger, FF, I do in a transverse direction, okay, U in L. So I add something from the external world concentrated. So the idea here is to apply something on the here, F02 in 0, because you can have F02 in the transverse direction. This make work on U, not on W, or a couple, M0 theta in 0, if you have the external world here. But the same here, L1, FL2, ML. So here maybe we can say this, instead of put 0, I should put it's better this way, 0, and then you should add FL1WL plus FL2UL plus ML theta L, concentrated. So the work is this action that you don't know what is it, a posteriori maybe you can interpret as force or as moment, we will see why. And this must be put outside the integral sign. So this is for Timoshenko. If now you impose that your rotation, the theta, follow the line of the displacement, It is possible to prove that theta is equal to u prime. If theta is equal to u prime, this is zero. So you don't have this part. Okay? However, it's not true because we have this kt. So it is true that u prime minus theta is zero. But kt, what is kt? Kt, for example, here, kn is a rigidity of this deformation. Km is the rigidity of this deformation. Kt is the rigidity of this deformation because you accumulate strain energy as much as this difference is different from zero. That means that if you do this, you accumulate energy. If you impose that this is very hard, so hard that it is impossible to displace, means that this goes to infinity. So you have infinity multiplication with zero. So in principle you don't know. It is possible to prove that in Euler beam, in fact, this u prime minus theta go to zero in the same way, for this, in the same power as kt go to infinite. Since here you have a square, this can be cancelled.
Isotropic,
homogeneous, elastic, linear material, Km is equal, if you do the Sampson theory, is equal to Young modulus of this three-dimensional material multiplication of I, that is the moment of inertia of the section with which the beam is built. And kT is given by GE, and G is something that go to infinity most of the time.
Are you sure about the notation, as the dimensions doesn't seem to be matching? On the Km and Kn,
yeah,
you have
different dimension. These are different dimension. Different dimension. You see from here, you can see from here. This is meter square. No, okay. This is non-dimensional because W is meter. W prime is non-dimensional because the derivative is dW over dx, so it's non-dimensional. So this is the unit of measure of an energy divided by a length, because it is under the sign of integral. Theta is non-dimensional. Theta prime is 1 over meter. So the unit of measure of Km is different from this. And you can see from here. This is Newton over square meter. This is meter to the power 4. This is Newton over square meter. This is meter to the power 2. So this is Newton, and this is Newton meter to the power 2.
And about the kT in both Km and Kn?
Should be the same unit of measure of this.
Shouldn't it be something like J times G?
In different books they call it differently. So you can say EG, for example. In some books, yeah, these are the nomenclature, where JT is the same unit of measure of this, but differently defined.
So G is also a cross-sectional property?
Yes, cross-sectional properties. Yes, cross-sectional properties. And generally, as I comment with someone in the break, as far as the thickness, the section is thick, as far as this is small, this thickness is very small, this goes to infinity, and if this goes to infinity, this is equal to this, and so this is zero, so you will derive Euler beam.
Isn't he polar inertial cross-sectional
inertia? I don't remember the name, standard name for this, because for Euler beam is not important, this goes to infinity. But I think that in different books they call it in different way. So now calculation. Okay, we can do the calculation directly for Euler beam. So for Euler beam, what do we have? U prime equal to theta. And we assume that U prime is 10 to theta in the same power as kt go to infinity. So this is square, so this is zero. Theta prime is U second. Okay? So, delta A, and A is equal to U minus Ux. So, delta A is the variation of this. So, it is integral from 0 to L of the variation of this. See, the variation of this is Kn W prime delta W prime. Where, because the variation, so A, the action is a function of U, W and theta. The variation of the action is defined as the action in U plus delta U, W plus delta W, theta plus delta theta, minus the action in U, W and theta. And then, this is the variation, and you should calculate the variation for arbitrary delta U, arbitrary delta W, and arbitrary delta theta. So also small delta U, small delta W, and small delta theta. So it is the same as the first derivative. So this is the reason why, I mean, you can do calculation from here, for example. The variation of this term is given by 1 half Kn W plus delta W prime to the power 2 minus 1 half Kn W prime to the power 2. No? With this definition, you have the variation of the action is the action evaluated in W plus delta W minus the action evaluated in W. But this is equal to 1 half Kn W prime square plus 1 half Kn delta W prime square plus Kn W prime delta W prime minus 1 half Kn delta W prime square. So this and this is cancelled. This is arbitrary, so also small. So this can be reduced, can be cancelled, and remains this. So it is the same that the derivative rule. 1/2 x square, you make the derivative, it is x. The derivation of x square is 2x.
Why did you vanish this last term?
Which term? This one. No. We must calculate now. So the variation of the action is this term plus. So this is the interpretation of the variation of this term. I can cancel, probably. I cancel this derivation, this standard, plus Km u second delta u second, minus the variation of this. So it is minus Bn delta w, because Bn is the same, is something that does not change, does not depend upon w. No. So the rules is always this evaluated in w plus delta w minus this evaluated in w. So it remains the poor Bn delta w. And so also minus bt delta u minus mu delta theta. Ah, of course, if theta is equal to u prime, it means that here mu is mu u prime. Therefore, here is mu u prime. Okay? Dx minus all of this. So it is minus delta minus delta minus delta minus delta minus delta minus delta. This minus this, where delta theta is delta u prime, no? Because theta is u prime. So it is delta u prime in L, and here is delta u prime in 0. And this is delta A. So the trick now is the following. What is this term? This term is also equal to Kn w prime delta w everything prime minus Kn w prime prime delta w. Because if you have two functions and you make the derivative, you know that this is equal to f prime g plus f g prime. So this is equal to this minus this. And what is the trick? The trick. The trick is that now you can elaborate the theorem of Torricelli. I don't know in Iran what is the name, but there is maybe one name for every country. If you have the integral of the derivative, this is equal to Kn w prime delta w at x equal to the L minus Kn w prime delta w at x equal to 0. So this term is put there. This term, what is it? Let us assume that the rigidity is constant for all the bar. So we are dealing with homogeneous bar. Of course, if you want to model, for example, a beam that has a cross section here and then a cross section that is reduced, you cannot do this. If you can do, Kn is constant, so the derivative of Kn is zero. And so this means that you have Kn W second. Okay? So that means that here you have minus Kn W second delta W prime. So the idea is that in this case you have minus a second derivative here, and you remove here. So this term was replaced by this minus this. This is replaced by this sum, and this is reinterpreted here. So this can be cancelled. And the same here, because you can say, so the same here, because this term is equal to Km U second delta U prime minus Km. Even in this case, let us assume that Km is homogeneous. So this is U third delta, no, U third delta U, no, U second delta U, U second delta U prime. Is it true? So the no, moment, it is so. No, aspetta un attimo. Yeah, it is so. You see? The derivative of this product is the derivative of the first multiplication of the second, that is cancelled with this, plus the first, the derivative of the second, that is this one. So this can be replaced by these two differences. This is replaced by a boundary condition, by not boundary condition at this moment, by this this form. So Km U second delta U prime at x equal to L minus Km U second delta U prime at x equal to zero. At x equal to zero, this term, and this term is replaced by this interpretation, minus u third and delta u. Okay? And so we can cancel this. So this can be cancelled now, because this is replaced by this summation, and this has been replaced by this. Now let us see this again another time. So for Timoshenko beam, this trick is given by only one time, because it is a first gradient theory. For Euler beam, since the internal energy is U second square, this trick, it can be done in two times. For two-dimensional body or three-dimensional body, this trick is not integration by parts, but is given by the theorem of divergence. But from at the end, it's the same. So this part is replaced again in this way. So it is minus Km U fourth delta U plus Km, this is minus U second, no, U third, delta U prime plus Km is true, so the derivative of the first, that is cancel, the first, the derivative of the second, that is there. So again, this is replaced by these two difference. So this, since we have under the integral sign, is replaced by minus k m u third delta u at x equal to l plus k m u third delta u at x equal to 0. You remember, now we have a minus here, so minus plus. And this one, it can be interpreted simply by taking this plus, instead of third, you have fourth, and you remove here. And so we have given, we have dealt with both also of this. Another thing that we can see is this one, because so minus mu delta u prime can be given by minus mu delta u prime plus mu prime delta u. The derivative? Okay. So, if the external couple is constant, if the external couple is constant, this is zero. Okay, if not, you have this. Okay, but this part, how can be cancelled? It's cancelled in this way, because again you have, we can put it here, minus mu delta u at x equal to l plus mu delta u at x equal to 0. I want to put here the reason it will be clear after that. So this can be replaced by that, and this can be replaced by this way. Okay? This is now is there. Okay, now these are the calculations, very simple at the end. So this we have already taken into account, because this part has been replaced here, and this part has been replaced here. So we can cancel. So now you can see the variation of the action that must be zero for any admissible kinematics. So, for example, it is for any admissible W. So, at the end, we can say that this is the integral from 0 to L. So, delta action is equal to the integral from 0 to L of what? Of delta W multiplication of minus Kn W second. And we have deal with this, and then we can deal with this. So minus Bn delta W and stop. Plus delta U, and now you have this. So Km U fourth minus bt plus mu prime. And so all the integral now are being reassumed here. Therefore, this can be cancelled. So this integral part, this, 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 and this, we have already. We have already where we have here. So, since delta u is zero for any admissible kinematical fields, okay, this is dx, it means that your partial differential equations are this is zero and this is zero, and this is the derivation of the Euler beam partial differential equations.
Why didn't
you want
this?
Sorry?
External concentrated force.
Because you may need to have the variation of the action is zero for any admissible kinematical field, also in the interior. That means that this is zero, because this is not zero, you will always find a delta W for which this delta A is non-zero. So this must be zero for sure. But it is not finished, the story, because if the partial differential equations are satisfied, you do not guarantee that the delta, the variation of the action is zero for any admissible kinematical fields, because we have all of these parts. And these parts are important because gives you all the possible boundary conditions.
Yeah, I think that if you want that the derivation of action is zero, these terms should be constant. And you
can no, constant. Must be zero. If we want the delta A action is zero for any kinematical fields, means that this is should be zero. This should be zero, and also all of this should be zero. Now we elaborate this. A moment. Now we will elaborate this part. For example, we can say delta W in L. We can say that delta action is also plus delta W in L, multiplication of what? Of this with minus sign, so minus F L1, and we are taking into account this part, and then where is it? This one. You see, delta W at x equal to L is there, with the plus sign. No, yeah, with plus sign. So this is plus kn delta W at L. And the blue one is here. You see other delta W in L? No. So you can you see that these two terms can be subsumed in this way.
They should be equal to each
other. Moment. You must say the variation of the action is zero for any delta W. This part is here, so this should be zero for any delta W, for any admissible delta W. Therefore, if your external constraint prescribes that delta W at L is zero, or is given, delta W is zero, because it is prescribed. So it does not change, it cannot be changed. So the variation is zero. Okay, you already have your boundary condition. If your external constraint do not say anything about delta about W at L, delta W is arbitrary. However, delta action must be zero for any admissible delta W. So you need to prescribe this. And this is the dual boundary condition that you need. If you do this with the balance of force methods, you need to have an extra intuition for the boundary condition. Here is already there. If you insert in console, you can have. COMSOL has the possibility to solve the problem directly inserting the internal energy. Then the boundary condition, you need to prescribe only kinematical boundary condition. And these equations, these boundary conditions, he calculates automatically. Because in fact, there is no intuition here. You need to make just calculation, also COMSOL can do. COMSOL is a computer, and he has no intuition. No? So you cannot, you need nothing to, you must not prescribe anything else. That your variation of the action is zero for any admissible kinematical fields. And so on with the other, because then you can say delta W at zero, multiplication of what? Of this, so minus F zero two, no, zero one, sorry.
Minus
Kn. It's here. Because it was the blue one, eh? This one. So minus F zero one, and then this, yeah, and then this. So minus Kn W prime in zero, and so you have this. So note, do you remember what are the very difficult investigation when you do this with balance, or when you need to understand the boundary condition with the aim of the balance of force and moments procedure, then you have to do some balance of force of very small piece at the boundary, and then you have to interpret the action, the characteristic of solicitation, or the actions, the axial action. And then you say, okay, the action of the right hand side on the left hand side is something, the action of the left hand side on the right hand side is something else, and then you do some balance, and then you find the calculation. And then finally you see that what they say, okay, N is Kn W prime, and then you say, N is equal to this, or if it is on the right hand side, on the left hand side, N is minus this. Here is already, you already have. You do not need to make an intuition on this sign. Because the sign is already prescribed by this.
You said that arbitrary delta W should be admissible, meaning that it should satisfy boundary conditions, kinematical boundary conditions.
Yeah.
But here you said we can choose arbitrary delta W something like zero all over the interval, except for at the end of interval we can use here like one, something like here, like this. Mm-hmm. And drive this boundary condition.
No, I mean, you, from the beginning, you say you have this delta action must be zero for any at arbitrary boundary condition. So in order to derive this partial differential equations, you simply can say W is zero at the boundary and arbitrary in the inside part. Since this is arbitrary, these are the partial differential equations. For this, so now if you impose that this partial differential equation are zero and must be zero, here you don't have this anymore, because this is zero. This is zero. So this is cancelled now. Of course you have to, and you say that the partial differential equation are this one and that. Now you are here. Even in this case, this is zero for arbitrary W. So this blue is interpreted here, so arbitrary delta W. Arbitrary, since this is arbitrary, this is zero. Not arbitrary W, arbitrary delta W. W is the solution, it cannot be arbitrary. Eh? And the same for delta U, because now you can say plus delta U at L, multiplication of what? On this, minus FL2, the pink one, delta U of L, where is delta U of L? Is here. So minus km u third, but also here, so minus mu. And so plus delta u. Ah, no, 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 there is another. Okay. Ok, plus delta U in 0, multiplication of this, so minus F02 and that, so plus Km U third with plus, plus mu. We do not have finished because, okay, so we have inserted also this, this, and this. We do not have finished because we have this, 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 and this. But this is, what is it? It is, I can put it here, so delta U prime at L, multiplication of this, so minus M, at L is here plus K, ah, this M, this was ML, eh? So minus ML plus this one, KM U second, of course at X equal to L, plus delta U prime at zero, multiplication of what? Of this, so minus M0, and it remains this, so it is, here we have a minus, so minus Km U second at zero, okay? And so this also we have cancelled. This is cancelled and remains this. So we have the partial differential equation and boundary condition in this form. Now, boundary condition must are made explicit only once you have the kinematical external constraint, the kinematical constraint. If you have something on delta U, for example, you, do you remember this example? No, do you remember? We have not done. This was an example, huh? So here you have a kinematical constraint of U and W and U prime. You remember it was U at 0 equal to 0 and theta at 0 equal to 0. This was the external boundary condition, the external kinematical constraint. So U and 0 equal to 0 means that this is 0. That means that delta U is zero, and this is not taken into account. Delta W at zero is zero, so delta W is zero, and also this, because theta in zero means, since this is the Euler B, theta in zero means U prime in zero equal to zero. So delta U prime in zero is equal to zero, so this is not taken into account. So the extra boundary condition comes from here, because W at L, there is nothing here, so this must be zero. Moreover, FL1 is zero here because there is no action in this direction. So W prime at L equal to zero. Here we do not have mu. U at L is not prescribed. We do not have mu, so Km U third is equal to minus L2. Minus FL2, but FL2 is minus F because FL2 is as this direction. So FL2 is equal to minus F. So your boundary condition is Km U third equal to F. And here we do not have couple, so U second equal to zero. Stop. We have all the boundary condition that is necessary to arrive to this problem without thinking anything. You change the boundary condition. You make this roller, for example. Instead of having this boundary condition, you have W at L equal to zero. Instead of have this boundary condition, instead of have this boundary condition, you have this. Simply.
If you don't know how much is the U, mu.
If you not don't know?
How much is the mu here?
This one, yeah. Okay.
How can you say that FL2 is equal to...
You cannot. You need to know the external... If you have your body, you can do some engineering derivation only if you know the action on your body. If you know the action, you can know what is the kinematics. If you do not know the action, it's impossible to know. For example, in European normative, but also in Iran, I'm sure, you need to prescribe, for example, in your structure, that the action of the wind has this kind of external action. And then you can design with this.
How can we find the boundary condition FL2?
This one?
Yes.
This is prescribed by the commitment, by the problem, or by the normative if you are an engineer and you want to make design. For example, you need to know to do a bridge in this place, or you need to know an house, a school, for example. Then the norms say, okay, you should take into account that in particular this BT, that is the transverse force per unit length, is given by something. If instead of a school is an house, maybe this can be smaller, no? Because the school is important. An hospital should be higher, because you need to design something with very large BT. If it is an house, okay, and maybe we can finish here. But the idea is that now you can do. Maybe for the next time that we will meet, we will see how. But you can do the derivation from a theoretical point of view, the derivation of this problem, for example. With a force here. No, maybe here. No? Otherwise, it's not possible.
Excuse me. Is there anything here between these two rods? Is there any hinge or a swivel?
This is an internal clamp. No? That means that here you have two bodies. For example, you can say, okay, this is S, this is X, this is Y. What does it mean, that this internal clamp? It means that, and you say that this U1 and this U2, this beam 2, this beam 1, as a restriction here, because you can say that W at L, if this is L, in this direction, is equal to minus U at W1 at L, minus U2 at L. Why minus? Because U, the W is, if this is the beam, and this is the direction of the abscissa, displacement is in this direction. Transverse displacement, in which direction, is such that with the rule of the right hand side, this finger go outside the blackboard, and this is the direction of U. And means that if this is the direction of Y, means that U2 is positive in this direction. So this is the kinematical external constraint. The other one is that U2 at L is equal to W, sorry, U1 at L is equal to W2 at L. Because U1 at L go up, and then the rotation is the same. So it is U1 prime at L equal to U2 prime at L. Then U, W and U prime in zero are zero. Here what do you have? You have W and theta at zero are zero, and stop. But for the external world, so you do not have any distributed force, but for the external world, you have something that do work on minus U in zero, minus.
Can you please repeat it again?
Of course. So your external world, what is it here? There is no distributed world. The only external action is given by here. But this is something that do work in not on the transverse displacement. Transverse displacement, so U of the second beam at zero, because it is a concentrated force, is a concentrated action, but U2 at zero is positive in this direction, so the work is minus, so minus F. Okay? And then you will see that the partial differential equation is simply U1 fourth is equal to zero, W1 second is equal to zero, U2 fourth is equal to zero, W2 second is equal to zero. So you will deal with an ordinary differential equation of the order 12. Because 4, 4, 2, 2, the order is 12, and you need to have 12 boundary conditions. The kinematical boundary conditions are 3 from here, 2 from here, and 3 from here. So, 3 from here, 3 from here, and 2 from here. So 3, 3, 6, 2, 8. You need further 4 boundary conditions. In the variational derivation, you will see that you have also this boundary condition, the dual, because where this F is considered. So one boundary condition will derive from here, and the other also from here, because you will see that if you imply this external constraint, you will see in the calculation that at the end, if you assume this kinematical restriction on your kinematics, if you assume this kinematical restriction, you do not guarantee that the delta action is zero for any. You need to assume further three boundary conditions. So you will arrive to 12. And this boundary condition corresponds to the balance of this place. So you have the counterpart. In balance approach, you assume the balance of this. For variational derivation, you will arrive deriving from, if you assume this, for the three boundary condition are already derived directly without thinking about any balance.
Are these three equations exactly the same as those three?
So
we have 3, 3, 2.
So we have three. We have three. So kinematics are 3 plus 3. These three are these three. Plus 2, and we have 8. Then we have one of these, so 9. And then we have 9. But we will see, you will see, that if you assume this and deal only with this 9 boundary condition, you do not guarantee that delta A is equal to 0. In order to guarantee that this delta A is equal to 0, you need to see further 3 boundary condition. You see from the calculation. And you also will see that this boundary condition corresponds to the balance of force and moments of this place. That are different from this. These are the kinematical boundary condition, and these are the dual. These are static boundary condition or dynamic.
So we have to, for example, set these geometrical constraints into those equations and extract dual boundary condition.
You need to prescribe. From this prescription, you calculate this delta A, you prescribe this, and you will see that in order to impose the delta A is equal to 0, you need to prescribe other boundary conditions that are the dual of this. We should see the calculation, but this can be an exercise, and then we will do it together next time.
It's basically two forces and one moment from the joint.
Two forces and one moment. Yeah. And these two forces and one moment corresponds, you will see that this corresponds to an axial force here, because corresponds to this. Transverse force, I think, no transverse force. And one couple that is equal to F multiplied by L, for sure. This is in linear case, because for non-linear case, this you do very high, and this can be, you have also some force in the vertical direction. But you will not see in this world, because in this world the internal energy is only quadratic with respect to u second. So you don't see any non-linear effect. But we can do also a lecture on nonlinear Euler beam. It's not standard, but a little bit more complicated. Not a little, it's more complicated, but it's possible. I have also the lecture notes for this.
You said that these two terms are not taken into account.
Which terms?
Two terms associated with the...
The distributed one. No.
Two terms, because the times for delta W at 0, delta U at 0, and delta U prime at 0.
Okay.
You said that these are not taken into account.
No, are taken into account. But for example, here, Wn0 is zero because of the kinematical constraint. So this is not... So you assume that Wn0 is equal to zero, therefore delta Wn0 is zero, so this is automatically zero.
So,
so this is not taken into account.
And we can say that it's equal to zero.
This is not zero.
But we use it in console lecture.
No, we use only if you don't have a kinematical boundary condition. If you have some restriction, you cannot use this. Or another interpretation, is that this F can also be interpreted as the Lagrange multiplier of this restriction. So another interpretation is to say, okay, this is arbitrary, but this is the Lagrange multiplier of this, but this necessitates some little bit more explanation. But anyway, if you assume kinematical boundary condition here, this is a kinematical boundary condition, you do not have any necessity to derive the dynamic bond, the corresponding dynamic boundary condition. One thing that you can do is the following. You know that the action n is kn w prime. At the end you can arrive to w. You know what is it w. W at each point. And you make the derivation, calculate W prime in zero, multiply by Kn, and you know the action here. And so you know the automatically the reaction corresponding to this kinematical boundary condition. But this is a process a posteriori that you can do. After the solution, you can derive your reactions. After the solution, you can derive the reaction. This, for example, here, you have a force. What is the force that is here? The force that of this clamp that this clamp apply on this section. In principle, here you do not have, but you have U at the end of the story. You know that this force is equal to U third in zero km. So you have U, you have the force.
Actually, we use this equation.
The same. Yes. At the end will be the same. We can prove that it's the same, but in this derivation you cannot see. It is not logic because. But at the end, in fact, the force that is here is exactly km u third. But here the force is not even a name of this story. It is something. It does not exist in this variational derivation, so you cannot even mention. The only things that you can do is what is the displacement, or what is U third. Then you are very smart. You know that U third is connected to the force, and so you can derive the force. But a posteriori, and hiding your calculation from this method, but okay, at the end is the same.